Good evening. Welcome, everybody, to our second week of this fall series called Sizing Up the Presidential Race. A lot of you got to come last week and hear John Geer, and tonight we are honored to have Carol Swain. I'm going to introduce Dr. Swain, and then we have a short video that we want to play before she begins her talk tonight, and then hopefully we've been reserving time for Q&A, so hopefully you're up for that. We said last week that the goal of this series was to bring in scholars and political scientists with varying points of view to offer thoughts on this presidential race and the current state of American politics. And so that's what we have been trying to do. And so tonight we welcome Carol Swain, who is a professor of political science and also a professor at the law school at Vanderbilt. Dr. Swain is passionate about empowering others to raise their voices in the public square. She's authored award-winning books, including Black Faces, Black Interests, The Representation of African Americans in Congress. Black Faces won the Woodrow Wilson Prize for the best book published in the U.S. on government, politics, or international affairs in 1994, and was cited by the U.S. Supreme Court Justice Anthony Kennedy in Johnson v. DeGrande, and also by Justice Sandra Day O'Connor in Georgia v. Ashcroft. Dr. Swain's other books include Be the People, A Call to Reclaim America's Faith and Promise, Debating Immigration, The New White Nationalism in America, Its Challenge to Integration, which was nominated for a Pulitzer Prize, and Contemporary Voices of White Nationalism. Professor Swain has served on the Tennessee Advisory Committee to the U.S. Civil Rights Commission and currently serves on the Advisory Board of the National Endowment for Humanities. Her opinion pieces have been published in the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, Washington Times, and the USA Today. She has appeared on BBC Radio, NPR, CNN, Hannity, Lou Dobbs, A360, the PBS NewsHour, the Washington Journal, and ABC's Headline News, among other stations. She is a foundation member of the Virginia chapter of Phi Beta Kappa. Before joining Vanderbilt in 1999, she was a tenured associate professor of politics and public policy at Princeton University's Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs. And we're honored to have her here tonight. So she's not going to come up right now, but you join me again in welcoming Carol Swain.
We were the poorest of the poor, and that was a part of the identity. I'm a university professor now, but I never can remember a time growing up that I ever said, I want to be a university professor. I was born and raised in the rural South, and I was one of 12 children. I was second from the oldest. We lived in extreme poverty. The early part of my life, we lived in a two-room shack, and it was literally a shack. It's so tiny. And my elder sister and I and some of the younger, the children that were the first kids, we slept on the kitchen floor. The house did not have any running water or indoor plumbing, and not having a bathroom in the house, and so really having what the older people call a slop jar in the house and having to empty that, those are things that made it very difficult. You had to put a pot on the stove and heat up the water to bathe in, and all of us bathed from that same cruddy pail of water. And you know, you can imagine by the time it got to the third or fourth kid, it's pretty dirty. And it was not uncommon for us to go into the local dumps looking for whatever we could find. Growing up in that shack, all I can remember is just sadness. It was very depressed. I always felt unloved. There was always conflict in the house. There was never enough of anything. There were fights every Friday when my stepfather got paid. There would be a fight between my mother and the stepfather, but these would be really violent fights. The most graphic memory is my stepfather chasing my mother with an axe, threatening to kill her and the children, we were running around, you know, grabbing at his legs, trying to protect our mother. Later, my mother moved to the city when I was probably 12 or 13 and became involved with social workers and welfare programs. And what I watched happen in my family was that it became a way of life for her and for some of my siblings. And I saw what a trap welfare is, and for many people, and still for some of my siblings, they've never held a steady job. At that time, I was a high school dropout. I had dropped out after completing the eighth grade. I felt shame, I felt fear, I was depressed. And so I married at 16, not because I was in love. I married a neighbor that was a little bit older, just to get away from home. Part of the misery that I experienced in my childhood, some of it just continued into my marriage and into my early life. At some point, I started taking bottles of pills and I really wanted to die. I had the experience of being in the hospital after one of my suicide gestures, having a medical doctor tell me that I was intelligent, that I was attractive, and that kind of shocked me because I was, you know, at least 20, 21, and I'd never heard anyone tell me that I was attractive. He said, "You're intelligent, you're attractive, you can do more with your life." I took a job outside the home, I filed for divorce. Everything started to change, and at one of the nursing homes where I was working as a nurse's aide, I met an African orderly from Sierra Leone. He said, "You ought to go to college." And those words changed my life. I studied hard. I earned my GED. I worked hard doing whatever I could do to get by, and I was able to graduate from a community college, go on to a four-year college, and graduate magna cum laude, and I went on to earn several graduate degrees. Somehow, I always believed that I could do it, that I could better myself, that I was not meant to be poor. I was able to far exceed anything that I imagined for myself or anyone else probably that was watching my life unfold. These milestones, my accomplishments, didn't come easy. It was through hard work, it was perseverance, a can-do spirit that I attribute to the grace of God. It is so amazing what a little encouragement and direction can do. But the system itself doesn't encourage people to better themselves. The social welfare programs that we have in America puts a band-aid on the problem, but it does not fix it. The only thing these programs do is create, in the long term, a sense of entitlement that results in a loss of self-worth for the individual. The truth is, people feel good about themselves when they can work and provide for themselves and for their families. Thank you for coming out, and appreciate the young man watching that video. It's probably rated R, you know, because it's depressing. You might have nightmares tonight. So pray before you go to sleep. Well, some of you are wondering how I became a university professor and ended up at Vanderbilt. And I'll give you the shortened version of that so that we can get to the politics. During my years at Princeton, I was pretty much agnostic. I had been had some experiences with spirituality while I was younger. My family, they were Methodists. My great-grandfather was a Methodist pastor. I hung out with Jehovah's Witnesses for a while, and then I left religion for about, I lose count, 20, 25 years maybe. But during that time, I would describe myself as spiritual. because I always knew that there was something larger than me guiding my life. And as a child, I always felt like there was something I was supposed to do. I had a sense of what I would describe today as the call. But at that time, it was just a sense of urgency. I also had the experience at different points in my life where strangers came up to me and said, "You're going to be famous someday." I don't consider myself famous, but I've come a long way since that video, right? So, and I would say that those people were prophetic types. They were trying to encourage me at a time when things seemed hopeless. So during my Princeton years, I was agnostic. And I went through a period where almost I got everything I wanted or things I thought I wanted. And that's not always great, but it seemed to be that way. And I was just totally focused on tenure, getting early tenure at Princeton. I was going to show them that a person from my background could go to Princeton and they could get tenure and they could do it early. And I did that. And as soon as I achieved that and I was earning more money than I had ever imagined, it was like it did not bring satisfaction. I sort of slipped back towards the depression, and that put me on a journey that eventually culminated with my being born again. But when Vanderbilt came along, I was at Princeton, I was dissatisfied, and I can tell you the truth, I never quite fit in anywhere. So I didn't fit in at home when I was growing up. I felt like I had been dropped from outer space, and I can remember watching my family thinking, "Who are these people? They're weird." I didn't fit in at home, and so I've never really fit in anywhere. So when I read in the Bible that God's people are peculiar people, then I feel like, okay, that's me. Family, I understand. But when Vanderbilt came along, I was not a born again. Except I'm not sure exactly how you count when you exactly get saved, because I know that at some point, you know, I knew that there was a God. I knew that He was guiding my life, but I was not at the point where I was a Christian in the traditional sense. And I would have said one God, many paths. So I was on, you know, my spiritual journey, I guess, when I was approached by Vanderbilt and when I was hired. And some of my biggest concerns were, probably the number one concern was, I was going to be in Nashville, and some of you church folks were going to come up to me and ask me, "Where do you go to church?" And I wasn't going to have an answer because I wasn't going to be in a church. And so that was what I was thinking, that I was more New Agey, more Eastern, and you know, I just was kind of out there. And so I was really worried about being in the Bible Belt. And the way God would have it, I negotiated my sabbatical from Vanderbilt up front. So they hired me. I delayed coming for a year, and I went to New Haven to get another degree. And I earned a master's degree in law. I'd had a PhD in political science. I'd been a political scientist. But because there was so much interest in my first book by lawyers, and they were citing the book Black Faces, Black Interests was used in a lot of redistricting cases. I was on the forefront of saying that whites would support black candidates and that when black candidates lost, it wasn't because of their race, but because they were more liberal, and that political party was more important than race. Because if you looked at Democrats and you looked at Republicans, it was pretty much political party that you saw the major differences. And so in that book, I kind of argued that if you continued to draw majority black districts, you would elect more Republicans. That meant there would be less people in Congress to support your agenda. And that book, I'm kind of lost at why I'm telling you about Black Faces, Black Interests. But that book, yeah, now I know. It created excitement among lawyers. And it made me think, gee, maybe I should have been a lawyer. If these people are excited about my work, maybe I should be a lawyer. And so I decided I would go to Yale Law School and do the one-year master's program, which is the first year of law school. And I would decide whether or not to continue to get a JD. And while I was there as a student, which meant took a great deal of humility to go back there, right, as a student, when there were other students that had been at Princeton or I had encountered who were also students there at the same time. But I went there, did the one-year master's program, and decided, for two reasons, I decided that, no, I did not need to become a lawyer, that there are enough lawyers in the world, and that whatever they liked about my work, that I could continue doing it as a political scientist. And so I was in New Haven for that year, and while I was there, I had my conversion experience, which means is that Vanderbilt hired one person, and a different one showed up for work. And so it's been a rocky road ever since. And what I've learned about God is that he has a tremendous sense of humor. And I cannot think of anything more hilarious than taking someone from my background and situating them at Princeton as their first job. Can you imagine? I had to learn the social skills as well as, you know, the subject matter and how to teach and all of that stuff. And I spent most of those years being painfully shy. I had enough sense to know I didn't fit in. But my work was well received, and I was a hot shot when I was hired. I got a signing bonus, and now my has-been. Once you become a Christian, things change. But I had the Christian conversion experience while I was in New Haven, so I found God at Yale. And what was different about that conversion experience is that I knew that my life did no longer belong to me, if it ever did, that my life belonged to Jesus Christ. And it has affected everything I do. And so my whole worldview and how I see myself in the world. And before that, I had been painfully shy, so much so that when Good Morning America wanted me to be on the TV for my first book, I turned them down because I was afraid. And then when I did my second major book, which is The New White Nationalism over there, that was after I had had the conversion experience, and I felt like God had given me a message that was bigger than me. And that book, you know, which probably sold 5,000 copies, it made everyone angry because it didn't end the way people thought it was going to end. I actually conclude by saying that blacks and whites both have a responsibility to work together for America, in the sense that I believe identity politics, there's no way that our nation can survive as long as we identify as something other than Americans. And so if you have every group having its own separate interests, there's no focus on the American whole. And so my concluding chapter had all these policy recommendations. A lot of people who were more liberal read the book on white nationalism and the chapters, and when they got to the conclusion, they were very disappointed. And some people that were conservative thought that, well, they thought, you know, that I was saying that they were white nationalists. And I can tell you that I did not title the book, nor did I choose the cover, but the publisher did. And that book identified conditions that I thought were convergent in 2002 to create a devil's brew for racial unrest. And if you look at what's happening now with Black Lives Matter and just various things taking place in the world, that book is like a now book. And when you think about the things with Black Lives Matter, what I see them doing is playing into the hands of white extremists that would like to have a race war. They would like to have a race war. And I don't know if any of you have read the Turner Diaries. It was a book, it was a novel, 1976, that was about a race war. And it starts with the government taking away the guns, and the blacks and the Jews and the groups that white supremacists hate. They're running the government, they're doing all this liberal leftist stuff. And a small band of patriots come and they take, overthrow the government. And then in the end, everyone's living in this lily white utopia. That's the way the Turner Diary ends. It was
Timothy McVeigh sold copies out of the back of his truck. And it's the FBI called it the Bible of the racist right. And so when I see what's taking place today, I see the political left. And I'm sorry if there are any Democrats who are bold enough to come here and you're not going to like this. I see the political left playing right into the hands of those people who would like to have a race war. And one of the things that I saw is that there's some legitimate issues that people have grievances about. A lot of us have grievances about, but politicians are not addressing them. Look what they're doing on college campuses. They're resegregating. You know, they're putting minorities by choice of going into separate dorms, and this whole vision of integration just going out the window. And so we are making serious mistakes in how we as Americans deal with America. So, so much for that. I'm here tonight to talk about Clinton versus Trump. Is there a clear choice? I would say yes, but before I tell you why, I will honor the night and the fact that I'm in a church, and we'll read some scripture. How's that? Now, this election has a lot of people. Most of us that care about America, you know, regardless of what side you're on, you know, you may be lying awake at night, some people may be worried. And the first thing I need to tell you is that it's okay, you know, that God is bigger than the affairs of this world. And that there are scriptures, and I will start with Daniel, I think it's chapter 2:20. That will say that God chooses the leaders. He raises up leaders, he deposes leaders. Sometimes they're evil leaders, but that God is totally in control of the government. And no leader rises, and you say, well, what about Hitler? The word is the word, and it says he chooses leaders. And sometimes he chooses nations to punish his people, especially when they've been apostate. And if you look at the United States, it pretty much fits an apostate nation pretty well. I can't see. Are they reading glasses? Did I bring my reading glasses? Is it 2:21? Daniel 2:21. Does anyone else have a Bible or reading glasses that they would like to loan me? Are those reading glasses?
They are.
Thank you. All right. Thank you. All right. I didn't tell you that I was a comedian, right? Okay. This is Daniel revealing Nebuchadnezzar's dream. Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. It is he who changes the times and the seasons. He removes kings and sets up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who know understanding." And so, you know, kings, presidents, prime ministers, God puts in place the governments. And so we don't have to worry that much. And in Psalm 75:7, we also get a similar scripture. And so that was Daniel 2:21. I'm going to Psalm 75:7. We'll get to the juicy stuff, but right now I'm going to honor the church. Well, this is, but God is the judge. He brings one low and he lifts up another. And you say, well, what does that have to do with it? You may recall that last summer, there were 17 or 18 candidates in the Republican race for president, and people were laughing about Donald Trump. I wasn't laughing. Last July, I wrote an opinion piece, President Trump, Stranger Things Have Happened, and I talked about why, or at least it's a very short blog, but the fact that he was connecting with people, and he was connecting with people, I think, because of the fact that our leaders have failed us so much. And at the risk of being totally weird, I pray, I'm a intercessor, and I felt like last summer, and you know, like, we'll know pretty soon whether or not I heard from God or if I just had a bad dream. Oh, I didn't mean it the way it's gonna come out. But I felt like the Lord said that Trump would be president. I told my closest friends, so I told a few people, and it didn't make me get behind him. I did not, he was not my first choice, he was probably not my second choice. I voted for Cruz because I am conservative, and I eventually started supporting Mr. Trump after the Cruz people started attacking every conservative that didn't seem conservative enough. But if you pointed out a flaw about Cruz, then you were bad. And so I started defending the Trump supporters on Facebook, and so the Cruz people decided that I was a Trump supporter, and so they started treating me like a Trump supporter, and so I became one. So right now, the scriptures that I've read is about God choosing leaders and lifting up people. And it's God that raises up some, puts down others, and you know, they're not always, you know, people that you may admire or people that you like. And I look at myself, out of my 12 children, I was the one that reached college. I'm the one that has the middle class lifestyle. And it doesn't seem fair, and it didn't seem fair to me when I was growing up. But, you know, for whatever reason, I feel very much like God chose me. So there are things that we don't understand why God lifts up some and then others don't get the same outcome. So God is in control of this election, and nothing catches him by surprise. And so anyone that's worried about it, I think that you can relax. The other thing is, this is a critical election. It will, whatever happens, will affect the course of the nation, you know, probably for the next 40 or 50 years. And whatever happens in America affects the rest of the world. So a lot is resting on this election. And they're Christians, you know, you look at our candidates and they're flawed. They're both flawed candidates, but then no one's perfect. No one is perfect. And I believe in a God that redeems people. And Jesus Christ died on the cross for our past, present, and future sins. And the standard that I see sometimes applied to Mr. Trump in particular is not very Christian, in that according to the gospel, I mean, you could be a mass murderer and you could have a Christian conversion experience. And of course, you're going to be, everyone has to pay for the consequences of that sin. They have to live with themselves and that type of thing. But you're supposed to be able to come, receive Jesus Christ and have him redeem you and wash you, you know, pretty much. He doesn't hold our past against us. And so his standards are not the same as our standards. If you look at the people that were used throughout the Bible, some of them were non-believers. Some of them, you know, were pagan kings. And then people who were flawed, like David. And it's not just David. I mean, we're all flawed, but God has always used the people that didn't fit the profile. And he's always been open to people who didn't fit the profile. And I think that we need to keep that in mind as we evaluate the candidates. And there are, among the things that are at stake, we know the Supreme Court. People talk about the Supreme Court. There's a cabinet. You can see by what's happening with the FBI, the Department of Justice, and Homeland Security that it matters who gets placed in the high cabinet positions. But there are also thousands of lower-level political appointments. I mean, I think the president makes from 4,000 to 5,000 appointments. And, you know, like the ones that that I had under President Bush were lower-level appointments. The NEH, that was confirmed by Congress, but it was a voice vote. It's not controversial, giving out money. And so that's at stake. And so when you think about it, if you don't like how the bureaucracy is being run, you have to realize that the executive branch, the whole executive branch, is at stake. And many of the decisions that make our lives miserable are being made through administrative law by lower level people. And those people would be replaced with other individuals who may be more likely to have a worldview that would be compatible with Bible believing Christians. And when I talk about Christians, I realize that we all don't agree. And there's some Christians, many of the people in the divinity school, you know, they have their own interesting take on the Bible. They're not necessarily Bible-believing Christians, but for Bible-believing Christians, you're more likely, I think, to find them in one political party than the other. The hostility we see towards Christians, and the information has just been revealed about one of the presidential candidate staff, how they denigrated Christians and evangelicals. And we know that at our institutions that there's a lot of hostility towards Christians. And there are people saying that we as Christians have to change the way we think, that we have to go along with the world. And for those of us who are pro-life, you know, even if you're not trying to get rid of Roe versus Wade, most of us, or a lot of us, don't want our tax dollars to go to supporting abortion. And for me, as a black person, I'm particularly concerned about abortion because there are some cities, New York City is one of them. At one time, it was a city in Mississippi where the black abortion rate was higher than the birth rate. And so can you imagine that for a minute? That the abortion rate of black babies was greater than the born alive rate, than people that were actually having babies. And so the majority of black babies in these cities were being aborted. And you look at Hispanic women and black women, their abortion rates are disproportionately high. And that's something that if the Democrats repeal the Hyde Amendment and make abortion covered by Medicaid, that means there'll be even more abortions among the poor and among many people that are minorities. And I think that's something that we should be concerned about. Do we want to contribute to that directly? We can pretend now that we're not contributing to it when our money goes to support Planned Parenthood. We really are, but the Hyde Amendment prevents them from using it to cover Medicaid abortions. That's one of the things that the Democrats have vowed to repeal. Vote. There are people that are saying because both candidates are flawed and disgusting that they're just not going to vote. Well, if you don't vote, that's a vote in a way. It's a vote for the status quo. And so if you like your country the way it is, then don't vote because that's a vote for the status quo. And you have a choice between the two major party candidates and then two third party candidates. If you vote for one of the third party candidates, if you are a Democrat and you vote for Jill Stein, then that hurts Hillary Clinton. If you vote for, who's that dude? Gary Johnson. If you vote for Gary Johnson, that will take away votes from Mr. Trump. And so again, that's still going to be for the status quo. It's not going to help your candidate. And you think about, what would God expect? Does God expect you to participate in elections? And I'm going to pause for a second, and if someone wants to chime in, what do you think? Is there a Christian obligation to participate in the affairs of state? Okay, I would agree with you that that is the case. And the scriptural support that I would use for that is one of the scriptures would be in Romans, where Romans 13, where we are told to be subject and obedient to the ruling authorities. Another is to render unto Caesar what belongs to Caesar. And, you know, that has to do with our governmental leaders. And so we have this system where we are, to be good citizens, we are expected to vote and participate in the affairs of government. And if we choose not to vote, that means that we are supporting the status quo. And many of the things that have happened in our country have happened because too many of us chose to stay home and not be involved. And there was a time when a lot of Christian leaders felt like that Christians shouldn't vote. And Jehovah's Witnesses, you know, they don't vote. They try to stay separate from the government. But if you don't exercise your franchise to vote, then it gives power to people who have an agenda. And if you look at America the way it is today, and I thought about bringing you all handouts. I have tons of handouts that I'm going to use for a different talk. But on Marxism and communism, and what I can document and show you all is that if you go back to the communist agenda, a large part of that from Karl Marx, it's already been implemented in the United States. And 1963, Cleon Skousen, who wrote The Naked Communist in 1958, in 1963, his appendix, which listed 45 current communist goals, and this was 1958 when the book was written, 1963, a Florida congressman read it into the congressional record. And if you look at those goals, a large proportion of them have already been achieved. And some of those goals were, I have them with me. Some of those goals were to infiltrate the churches, to promote homosexuality as natural and as good and healthy, to establish relationships with communist nations. It's a whole a bunch of those goals that have already been implemented. I counted like 15 or 16 of the 45. And I do have that handout here with me, but I just don't have it on the stage that I would be happy to share with someone. And I think that we should be concerned because this is a nation that was created or founded on Judeo-Christian principles. And no matter what people say, if you go back and you read, you look at the charters of the original colonies, many of them were Christian. If you go back and just listen to some of the debates or read the debates between the founders, you'll see that most of them, you know, had deeply religious views. And when they set up the Constitution to be, you know, we would say it's a secular document because it doesn't talk about Jesus Christ. It was signed in the day of our Lord, but it doesn't talk about Jesus Christ, but it protected freedom of religion, freedom of speech, freedom of association. All of those things are being threatened today by, it's being threatened by the political left. And those of you who watched the debate the other night, the question came up for both candidates, what type of Supreme Court justices will you appoint? And Mrs. Clinton said, I will appoint justices who understand the world. Mr. Trump said, I'm going to support justices who are in the mold of Justice Scalia, who will adhere to the Constitution. And to me, you know, like on many issues, the political parties are diametrically opposed. And so you have a clear choice. And there's one political party that at least in its platform, and I've passed out copies of the platforms, and the platforms are compared on issues that I think that most Christians, this is, if you want a copy of this, I've passed out copies, and it puts the party platform side by side so you can see what each party stands for. And, you know, you can really make a choice about what kind of country you want to live in. And for people like me who have a biblical worldview, then I support the Republican Party because of its platform. And there are plenty of people in the Republican Party that I think that they need to pack up and move on over to the Democratic Party. But they really, I mean, they were born, like I was born black. They were born into Republican families. And so they got involved in Republican politics, but their heart is someplace else. And it's hard to change parties. It was hard for me to stop being a Democrat and become a Republican. And so there are a whole bunch of people that have either infiltrated the Republican Party on purpose, or they were born there, their heart is somewhere else. I think that this election is really shaking out, and that people just need to go where they're most comfortable. And for me, as long as the Republican platform is as strong as it is on issues that I care about, that I think are foundational for our nation, then I'm going to be a Republican. And that helps me look past the personalities and the character flaws of the candidates, because the candidates are flawed because they're human beings. They're human. And I have no doubt that Mrs. Clinton is sincere about the things she believes in. She's passionate about those things. If we could ever get her to tell us truthfully what they are. But I'm sure she's sincere. Just like I think that Mr. Trump loves America. I think he's sincere. And but one thing that we do have, we have the party platforms. We have a party, one party that is committed, at least at the grassroots level, to God, country, and family. And for that reason, you know, I am a Republican, and I became a Republican a few years after I had my Christian conversion experience. First, I was an independent for a while. I was independent, but I was voting for Republicans. I just couldn't bear to bring myself to call myself a Republican. And when I finally did go, I found, you know, I came out as a Republican because I realized that I couldn't just stand in the middle throwing rocks at both political parties. I had to take a side. I still throw rocks at both political parties, but I do it as a Republican. And so that was a choice that I had to make. And for those of you all who are undecided, and it's hard for me to believe that anyone can be undecided at this late date, I think you do have an obligation to study the issues and the candidates and decide, you know, what kind of America do you want to live in? And that those sheets I passed out on party platforms, those are some of the issues that many of us find important. And so, you know, study the candidates, the issues, and then get involved yourself. I mean, you can volunteer, you can knock on doors, you can make phone calls, or you can run for office. And maybe God has called some of you all to run for office. You know, maybe you thought, you know, you were finished, or maybe you retired and you thought that was it, but maybe that's not it. Maybe God's calling you to do something more. And so I think that we need to consider running for office. And people that are really young and they have not, you know, they don't know yet what they're going to do, I think that that you have to be open. And you have to prepare yourself. We are not all going to be in the church. Like, for whatever reason, I've been in academia, but I know that God has called me, and I feel that He's called me, you know, to speak truth, and my degrees open up doors, and, you know, I get these opportunities to speak. But, and there's preparation that goes into it. And then there are people always that have a vision that they may keep to themselves because they think people in their family will laugh. They probably will. That's why you should keep it to yourself until you are ready, you know, until God positions you or shows you how to bring it about. But those things that you have in your heart, I think God places them there. And a lot of times you have these dreams and visions, and it can take 20, 25 years before whatever God has shown you will begin to happen. And I think about my life, you know, probably 20 years ago, I had people telling me that I was going to be speaking before millions of people and that I was going to be doing media and I was going to be doing all these things, and that wasn't manifested. I don't even think I would have or could have. And the only reason that I can stand in front of people and talk now is that God has just impressed on my mind that the message I have is more important than me, And during the time that I was shy because I thought people might laugh at me. Now I like for people to laugh. Thank you. Thank you very much. So pretty much, I think that's the crux of what I have to say. I'll be happy to take your questions. And thank you for giving me these glasses.
All right, I'll bring the mic around here.
Dr. Swain, could you speak at all about Saul Alinsky and the impact that he, as a communist, has had on the current president and the Democratic candidate, and maybe mention who he dedicated his book to?
Okay, I'll be happy to talk about Saul Alinsky. He's one of my favorite people. I quoted him on Facebook. He says, ridicule is man's most potent weapon. And so on Facebook, I posted, why are we not ridiculing the Democrats for saying that the Russians are trying to steal the election? That's really funny. That's hilarious. Funny. And if Republicans were saying something like that, they would be called conspiracy theorists. But somehow when the political left does such things, it isn't. And so the whole thing, the Bertha and various names conservatives get called to silence them, that's Saul Alinsky's strategy of ridicule. And no one wants to be ridiculed. And so it sort of silences people. And I don't know why conservatives are not very effective at using ridicule. Mr. Trump is trying, but he was a Democrat. And I'd also like to say that some of the most outlandish things Mr. Trump has done was while he was a Democrat. Okay, Saul Alinsky. Saul Alinsky wrote an important book that many of you should read, or all of you should read, called Rules for Radicals. And in that book, it's very short, he outlines strategies for transferring power from the haves to the have-nots. And what inspired him to write this book, which I think was published in 1971, was the Democratic Convention in 1968. And what he saw was the political left and, you know, people, they were, you know, they really felt shut out. And the protests that were taking place in Chicago at the Chicago Democratic Convention. And I mean, these were dirty people, dirty in that they had hippie-like clothes and unwashed hair, and they screamed obscenities, you know, at the police. And a lot of the parents and everyday Americans watching on TV, they were not sympathetic at all at these young people and what the young people were doing and how they looked and how they smelled. And Saul Alinsky told them they were doing it wrong, that to be able to make changes, they needed to go into the system. And his book, Rules for Radicals, is dedicated to Lucifer as being the very first rebel to set up his own kingdom. And so you get that, Lucifer. And he outlines 12 or 13 rules for redistributing power. And his strategy is pretty much is infiltration, deception, and manipulation. So he urged people, and anyone that's seen Hillary's America, thank you. I have about 20 minutes in that film, and it talks about Saul Alinsky. I'm not discussing him in the film, but the film covers Saul Alinsky and Mrs. Clinton's connection, because he was one of her mentors. But at any rate, with Saul Alinsky, he encouraged people to go into the system and change it from within. And when you look at the educational system in America, some of the things that are being taught in public schools, when you look at our universities, and he had socialist Marxist ties, and he was able to pretty much encourage the young people, okay, cut your hair, put on a suit, you know, clean yourself up. And many of those people went into the establishment. They kept their heads down low until they got a critical mass. Now they're running You know, they're, I would say they're running the government, they're running institutions, the universities, all of the microaggressions, trigger warnings, the various things you see coming out of the university's political correctness, all that's tied to cultural Marxism and socialism. And Saul Alinsky had a big impact on all of that because he showed the radicals how to do it. And when I teach my course on political culture, I focus on the impact of the communist movement on American political culture, and I have my students read the Communist Manifesto, part of Cleon Skousen's The Naked Communist. We read some Hayek, and one of the points that I hope students take away, especially the conservative ones, is that these are strategies that can be applied by conservatives as well, that there's no reason why young people can't go into academia, keep their heads down low, and move up the ranks. And then, you know, you do what the liberals have done. You hire people like yourself until you get a critical mass, and then you start implementing your agendas. If you wonder why all these corporations now are getting involved in social and political issues, it's because the young people have been educated on these campuses to be social justice warriors. They have been positioned in positions of power, so they're implementing their goals. And so with Saul Alinsky, he has been just required reading of the political left, and he was President Barack Obama's mentor, as well as Hillary Clinton. She wrote her senior thesis on him, and she met him, and they had connections. And so that's the answer to the question. You already know, but for the rest of you all, that's the answer to the question.
It was a setup.
I know. Thank you.
Tell us what you know about the Clinton son-in-law.
The son-in-law or the son?
Chelsea's husband.
I mean, what do you want me to say? That I'm not going to say that his daddy was a crook. What do you want me to say? The daddy served some time in prison for committing some type of crime, right?
I understand he has communist leanings.
There are lots of people in government now that has communist links and ISIS links and various kinds of links. But that's all I'm going to say about that.
What are your thoughts about moderates in general, to be a moderate today? And the second part of that is, what are your thoughts about the current civil war within the Republican Party, that there are a lot of respected Republicans who don't think Donald Trump is really a Republican? How do you sort out who is a real Republican, especially given some of the things that Trump has said and done in his past?
Well, I mean, what is a moderate? If a moderate means that you're independent, you see yourself as independent-minded, I don't see anything wrong with that. As long as, you know, you use rational methods to make your decisions. When it comes to concerns about Donald Trump, it goes back to my, you know, understanding of, for one thing, the Republican Party itself cannot survive unless it brings in people, unless other people come into the Republican Party. There are not enough older white people for the Republican Party to survive. And Donald Trump has shown his ability to expand the tent. And by the standards that are being applied to him, you could never grow the Republican Party. I myself don't feel really accepted as a Republican because I've been a Democrat most of my life, and so it takes a while for people to trust you and to accept you, and I think that sends the wrong signal to people who actually are attracted to some of the principles of the Republican Party. So I think the Republican Party shouldn't be driving anyone away, that they should be welcoming people with open arms, and then also, but also sticking with their platforms and their values. Yes.
Being an employee at Vanderbilt, I get the impression Vanderbilt's as liberal as can be. And you are pretty conservative. What's your interpretation? What do you think about that? Being a, you know, teaching there.
I said God has a sense of humor. I don't think either one of us got what we thought we were getting. I didn't know what to expect when I thought God was going to move me out of academia and I was going to become the next Joyce Myers or Beth Moore, or that I was going to be traveling around speaking and that he was going to move me into the ministry because I felt like my conversion experience was powerful enough. And so I actually thought God was going to close the door to academia and that I would have a different kind of career. I didn't imagine that he would leave me there all alone, you know, for 16 years. Can't believe that God did that to me. So it was not a good fit from the beginning. But at the same time, I have had many rewarding experiences at Vanderbilt with students. And I love my students. And I feel like I have a lot of support from the staff, some of the faculty. Some of the support comes under cover of darkness, but I still have support. And so I know that God has had me there for a purpose. And, you know, that's fine. But I had a different, I kind of thought after my conversion experience that God was going to take me other places.
Hey. Is it on? All right. Two questions. First of all, there's so much talk about the presidential race. I'd like for you to comment, because you're a lot more of an expert than me and probably most people in this room, about Congress. What do you think is going to happen with just potentially a turn in Congress? And based on who the presidential candidate is or nominee is, what do you think is going to happen to Obamacare? Seems like it's kind of on a destructive road regardless.
Right. I agree. Those are good questions. And I think with Congress, given the way the Republicans have sort of misused their power that they had in 2010, 2012, they have not been so effective as that they could have been. And I think that Boehner was a weak speaker. I think that Paul Ryan has been a weak speaker. And they have not adhered to the wishes of the people. And that's part of the reason we have Donald Trump, is that, you know, so many Americans are just fed up with voting for politicians. As soon as they get to Washington, they forget all the promises that they made. And so whatever happens with the Congress, we, the people, need to find a way to hold them accountable. We have not been very effective at doing that. And with Obamacare, you know, the Republicans, at least Donald Trump, the nominee, has said that he would repeal Obamacare. It's collapsing on its own. And, you know, like people like me and people that I know, our deductibles are so high that, you know, you avoid going to the doctor. We're not utilizing medical care that we may need at the same level because the deductibles are so high. And there's so many people that are struggling with the monthly premiums. It doesn't seem fair, and it can't continue to be that way. Yes.
A quick question. With your background that you showed us at the beginning and your own life, how do you see our society transitioning out of a cycle of dependency on entitlements and poverty into another way without leaving a whole lot of people dying by the roadside in the transition?
Well, first of all, we have never been a nation that allowed people to die by the roadside. And even before Obamacare, you know, there was the, I think it was called the Hale Burden Act, but there was something that if you were poor and you went to a hospital, could not turn you away and you could get assistance with your medical care. And so the poorest of the poor have always had Medicaid. The poorest of the poor in the United States have qualified for Medicaid. And so, I'm sorry, I don't want to break someone's glasses here. So that's not going to happen. I think that the entitlement programs that we have today are set up in a way that there's no real incentive for people to better themselves. At one time, you know, there was people that were on public assistance. They were given a choice between assistance with getting a job or getting education. Nowadays, you know, if the person, you know, they're barely making it, they get a job, they make $10 above, you know, whatever ceiling that's been set, then all of a sudden they lose their benefits. And our benefits are so generous that people are better off sometimes not working than working to better themselves. And so I think when it comes to entitlement programs, that we want to be a kind of nation that helps people that are trying to help themselves. And I have been able to attain the American dream, to come from that poverty, to be where I am today. And you ask me, well, how did I do it? Well, I worked and I got scholarships. And I don't tell many people this, but you know, you can fact check it and it'll be true, that I worked a 40-hour-a-week job at the community college library while I was getting my four-year degree. I graduated magna cum laude. And the other part of the story, and it's really a God story, I was a work-study student. And because the regular employees would call out sick, they wouldn't show up, the library would have a crisis, and I would be willing to work over. The director created a full-time job for me, 40 hours a week, nights and weekends, and I was able to use that. No one used the library at night anyway, and so I did my homework, and I graduated with honors, and when I decided to go to graduate school, they dissolved my job, and they hired two people. And so, I mean, you can make it in America. I was a work-study student. That's the lowest of the low. And I was able, you know, through that work, it became a full-time job. And I think that I've had opportunities and that there should be more opportunities for people to better themselves and not jeopardize their child care or whatever they're doing just because they may make $50 more than the government says they should. So entitlement programs can be rethought in a way that there's an incentive for people to better themselves, because people who are actually trying to live off of those programs, you can't afford rent, a car, insurance, you name it. Your quality of life is not going to be the same as someone that's actually working most jobs.
You mentioned that America was founded primarily on Judeo-Christian principles.
Yes.
As a matter of public policy, should America state that and move ahead and adopt Judeo-Christian principles going ahead? And the reason I'm asking that is because obviously a lot of countries in the world are being kind of overrun by Muslim immigration, and I'm just kind of curious, as a matter of public policy, how Americans should address that.
Well, you know, I think it's really tacky sometimes when speakers hawk their products, but I'll make an exception tonight. This book, Be the People, A Call to Reclaim America's Faith and Promise. I started working on it in 2009. It was published in 2011. And I deal with those issues, you know, about how America was founded and what the First Amendment guarantees and, you know, the separation of church and state. That is, you know, pretty much a modern conception of how you view the relationship between the country and the Constitution and Christianity. Because the people who founded our nation, they were Christians. And so they were not imagining a nation where you would have people that would be in the majority from other religions. And we have allowed the secularists to create an environment where Christians, who are the majority in America so far, the numbers are shrinking. And one reason the numbers are shrinking is that we've allowed the political left to silence us. And in this book, pretty much, you know, it's a call to the we the people, to stand up and be the people, you know, who reclaim our nation. Not by making it a theocratic nation, not by forcing everyone to adhere to our values, but taking our values into the public square. And I think that that's part of the reason is that most Christians don't know the Bible. They are easily intimidated, and I don't think they should be. And I think that if everyone would just commit to understand the Bible and asking themselves what they really believe. Do you believe there's a God? Do you believe the Bible was the inspired word of God? Do you believe God changed his mind? Some people would say that the Constitution is outdated. The Constitution is a living document. It changes with the times and the people. They will say that. Do you believe that's true of the Bible? Because that will affect how you approach life. And I think with America, we have lost our way. And we talk about God bless America. Why would God bless America? Is there anything about America today that God should bless or would bless if he's the same God of the Bible? Yes. I don't think so.
Yes, there is.
What?
Yes, there is.
What?
And I really kind of wanted to back up to what, the way you answered Dr.
Roller. There are a lot of people that find themselves in deep, deep poverty now.
Uh-huh.
You did not have the environment to encourage you and challenge you, but you've got an extremely intelligent mind, and you've got a lot of talent, and you've got a lot of people skill, and you've got just a lot of resources available to you that a lot of these folks don't
have.
So what
does that have to do with my question about what about America that God would bless?
Oh, it's, well, for I was just backing up really what Taylor was, but I'm going to say in a minute what I think that God blesses about America and continues to bless in America is the way that we do care about other people. I mean, whenever
I would argue that a lot of things that you do for other people and that you think you're caring about them, that you're making it worse off for those people. And
that may be true, but if you will just listen to me for just a moment.
Okay.
I have listened to you so very carefully, and I've enjoyed your words. But we will be sending aid to Haiti.
Yeah.
There will be millions upon millions of dollars. And as long as America still cares about
that.
The individual mm-hmm. person, there is something for God to bless about America. And it's not just Christians. Christians lead the way, yes, and we should. But there's a lot of just plain old Joes out there that just, you know, sit at home, get out on the boat on Sunday, whatever, that still care about people, give lots of money to nonprofit organizations to help people. St. Jude Hospital, the Shriners, lots of things that are not religiously oriented. God looks with favor upon that.
I don't know, because our salvation is not based on works. The salvation is not based on works, and a lot of the things that we do... Now, I'm not talking about that. I'm trying to answer your question now. Our salvation is not based on works. And so, you know, a lot of people that are not Christians, they give money to organizations and that type of thing. And some of the people that they're trying to help, they're making them worse off. And there are many people that will argue that abortions, I can read an Episcopalian pastor that argues that abortion is a blessing under all circumstances, that abortion is a blessing, and she believes that. In fact, I will read the quote from the book. Do you think God would bless a nation where we have killed 60 million unborn babies?
No,
we're talking about America. We're talking about America and whether or not God would bless a nation like that. Yeah, I'm not saying, did I say that you shouldn't do that? I didn't hear myself. If I said that, I'm sorry. It's not what I believe. It's not what I said. But let me read this quote from this Episcopalian. She's a dean of a seminary, Reverend Ragsdale. She says, "Abortion is always a blessing and never a sin. It is a blessing," she says, "when a woman wants a child but can't afford one because she hasn't the education necessary for a sustainable job or access to health care or daycare or adequate food. And when a woman becomes pregnant within a loving, supportive, respectful relationship, has every option open to her, decides she does not wish to bear a child, and has access to a safe, affordable abortion, there is not a tragedy in sight, only a blessing. The ability to enjoy God's good gift of sexuality without compromising one's education, life, work, or ability to put to use God's gift and call it simply a blessing." And Reverend Ragsdale is the president of Episcopal Divinity School in Massachusetts. Mother Teresa, on the other hand, says, abortion is the greatest destroyer of peace because we are able to destroy the life that is given by God. If a mother can become the murderer of her children, what can we say about other kinds of murders and wars in the world? Abortion is the source of all the evils in the world. And so these people are diametrically opposed on how they see abortion. If someone heard me say that I didn't think that we should help the poor, that's not what I meant to convey, because I came from poverty. And I've seen, you know, many people that have tried to help the poor. In fact, when aid to families with dependent children, when that policy was passed, I'm sure many people thought they were helping families. It had a rule, no man in the house. And so that meant that if there was a family where they were unemployed and the man was, he was a father, he was in the house, the wife had to get rid of her husband or the father of her children to be able to get governmental assistance. And that contributed, I think, to the astronomical single-parent households that we see in minority communities. That rule is no longer in place, but before that policy was put in place, only 25% of black households were female-headed. Now it's 70%. And so some of the things that we do make people worse off, and we do it with the best of intentions, and I think sometimes it does come out of guilt feelings. And so, I mean, you help people, but you also have to help them help themselves. And just as I said in that film, people feel good about themselves when they can work. And that's one of the things that you hear a lot of politicians promising jobs, promising to do something, but they're not really making it possible for certain groups to work. And no matter what you believe about the unemployment rate is based on people who are actively looking for work. There's something like 90 million people have dropped out of the labor force. And you're kidding yourself if you don't think that the illegal immigration and bringing in low-skilled workers, whether through a legal program or encouraging them to stay illegally, doesn't have an impact on Americans. It hurts the Americans that are low-wage, low-skill, and many of them are people of color. And so there are consequences to everything we do, and we are reaping the consequences of bad policy decisions. And we should make policy with our head and not with our heart, and I think that's biblical.
Let's do one more. We're at 7:45, so
okay.
Dr. Swain's going to be here to sell her books, and I'm sure she'll field a few more questions. Let's go with this.
I feel like Christians are being persecuted in America.
They are.
And I have an example of that. My friend works at Vanderbilt, and she was told by her manager to remove her cross necklace because it was offensive to the coworker Muslim who was given opportunity at the drop of a hat to go pray and given a space to pray. My question, and my friend, by the way, said, over my dead body, which it may come to that, actually, and she would not remove her cross. They cannot make her do that.
Well, if
yet.
She needs a lawyer, I can recommend some organizations.
Well,
organizations that would take
hence my
case.
Crosses. I'm just waiting for that to be said to me. But anyway, I guess my question is, I cannot wrap my head around the liberal thinking that acquiesces, that puts on a pedestal the Muslim faith, the Islam faith, and then has vile contempt, just absolute contempt for Christians. I can't get it. I don't know what the purpose is, because if they continue and they do take over as I think they plan to do, we're not going to have a country left, and Christians will be persecuted in a very frightening way.
Vanderbilt is not the only university that has become hostile towards Christians.
Sure,
but in the Ivy League schools that I'm familiar with, Princeton, Harvard, Cornell, Yale, they have not imposed the kind of restrictions on the religious organizations that Vanderbilt and some others have. And you may remember in 2011, the university adopted a policy that student organizations could no longer require belief statements or conduct statements. And so before that, if you were a Christian organization, your constitution and bylaws would say to be a leader, not a member, to be a leader, that you would have to affirm a belief in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And then they had biblical criteria for conduct. And so if you were a Christian leader, you couldn't be openly engaging in fornication, adultery, or homosexuality. The university said that the organizations could not impose those requirements on leaders. And so about half the Christian groups that were at Vanderbilt are no longer there. They're no longer recognized by the university. And if they're operating kind of underground, they cannot use the email system, they cannot use the bulletin board, they cannot have a table at a student fair. But some of them are chapters of national organizations. So with Crew and InterVarsity, if you're familiar with those organizations, they have teamed up with Belmont and Fisk. And so the Vanderbilt students are doing things with students at other organizations. But yes, you know, Christians are being persecuted in ways that other groups are not. And what I find very confident is that there are professors at Vanderbilt, like Professor Jim Blumstein in the law school, who, as far as I know, you know, he's an atheist or a secular humanist, and he has been very supportive of religious liberty and freedom. And there are people at Vanderbilt that believe in free speech, and they're not Christians, and they're not happy with the direction that universities are going in. And I would argue that when universities acquiesce to student demands and students come up with all kind of crazy ideas, when you go along with that, you're not helping the students, because they can have a safe space on campus. You can carve out a little room where they can segregate themselves. But when they get in the real world, they're going to have to work with people from all kinds of different backgrounds. And I think that universities are taking, you know, the path of least resistance or whatever. They're not helping the students. They're harming the students, and I kind of feel sorry for the parents who are paying all that money for the education.
All right, one last question for Dr. Swain. Since John Geer, your colleague, was here last week, and he made an election prediction,
right?
He predicted that Hillary would win this election. So would you like to make an election prediction for the next 27 days, whatever it
is? I'll make an election prediction that Donald Trump will win if the media starts covering Hillary's scandals. And if the Democrats don't steal the election with voter fraud. If you're following the news, there have been several incidents in Virginia, you know, where a young worker was caught. He had registered 19 dead people. In Pennsylvania, they found thousands of immigrants that were undocumented that had been voting. They voted in 2008, 2012. Indiana, they found voter fraud. The good thing about it is that they're finding it now, because once the election takes place, you know, they're not going to reverse an election because of voter fraud. But if you can catch it and prevent it before it happens, then it helps maintain the integrity of elections. And there's a need for people to volunteer to be poll watchers, to just watch and see if you see something suspicious, to report. And that's something that, you know, anyone can do. You know, you don't get paid for doing it, but you get to feel good about yourself and feel good about being part of the political process. So with that, I thank you all for being here. If I offended someone, I'm sorry. I'm not into political correctness. I pride myself on transparency. What you see is what you get. And that's it. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Swain.